So what if you could use AI to look at your fridge, go to the grocery store, figure out what you should make or what you could make, and get it all going? We're going to do that on the next episode of the Cozy AI Kitchen. You've been visiting the Cozy AI Kitchen and you're wondering, where's the food? Where's the cooking? Well, you're in luck because cooking is craft, and I thought there's no better person in the world to consult on the craft of cooking and design and craft than my dear friend, Tim Allen. Tim Allen, welcome to the Cozy AI Kitchen.
Thank you, John. It's great to be here. Thanks for having me.
Is it cold in there? People say it's cold in there.
It's a little chilly, but I like the breeze.
Okay. East Coast, go East Coast, go East Coast. You know, Tim, you had a recent interview about craft. Could you share some of your thoughts on craft for the audience, please?
Sure. I mean, I am just a designer, really, and I love design. Obviously, craft can be applied to anything, but I mean, I just feel like when you do something with passion, and with pride, and you're trying to perfect, you're on this pursuit of perfection, which you'll never really attain, but that's sort of the draw. You can apply that to design, you can apply that to music. I think that's the essence of craft.
Well, you know, having grown up in Japan, or actually lived a large part of your life as a child in Japan, I'm going to switch the toaster for a rice cooker just for you. One second. It's very important. Okay, let's see. Here we go. So this is the other version of the AI cookware of the kitchen, which is probably the right one. Okay, here we go. So first off, we're going to use two models. Everyone loves two models. They love choice, right? So two models. One is for the embeddings. The embeddings are how we take information and code it into long vectors of numbers and make it usable. The other model we're going to be using is a completion model, 3.5 turbo people like because of speed. Speed is a good thing. It's a craft sort of aspect, but also GPT-4 for the connoisseurs.
Yeah.
Okay, and also once in a while I use my temperature because I had food poisoning recently, so you want to make sure it's like the right temperature. So you want to make sure you have responsible AI. So another aspect of AI cooking that we have on the show. We're going to add some tokens up. We'll fill up some tokens. We're going to get some embeddings ready to go. And we're going to go and cook with AI. Let's get started, Tim. Are you ready?
Yes, let's do it.
Everyone feels so ready for this moment. Okay, let's jump in. And so Tim has a quote here that I pulled off of the Finding Our Way interview. It is an in-depth interview. I highly recommend it. What's the least amount of fidelity you can give to an idea that allows people to understand that it's a great idea? So this is what we're going to do with this idea of cooking with AI with Tim. Let's get started. We're going to bring over a NuGet package, semantic kernel. We're going to get ready those two models that we described, an embedding model and a generation model. And we're going to use GPT-4 for extra good inference. And this is the photo I took just 30 minutes ago at the local supermarket. And GPT-4V access, a so-called multimodal model, API access is not easy to get. So I'm sort of simulating that. I took a picture. I asked 4V to identify all the produce available in the image. It gave me back a list: asparagus, artichokes, eggplants, pretty good, yellow squash. And now what we're going to do is we're going to store some information as if we were a fancy hotel to understand the user's preference. For breakfast, they like eggs that are with low salt. For lunch, they have a calorie limit. So this is sort of preferences. This could be as long as anyone wanted. We stored that in the embeddings, and we can retrieve it with a query. I want to find something related to breakfast, and here's some breakfast instructions. Now what we're going to do is we're going to query what's in our fridge. This could be a plugin to your smart fridge, but I won't query the fridge while Tim's in there. So this is a very quick query, simulated query, mind you. So now I have three things. I have the meal preference, I have what's in the fridge and pantry, and what's available at my grocer. Next up, we're going to use a plugin to be able to, the plugin is called Cooking for Real, because we've been cooking for fake. This is real, we're with Tim cooking. It takes those three smidgens of information, and I'm going to give it to a meal suggester. So now, while it's cooking away here, Tim, what is your take on this way of coding? Just curious.
I think it rhymes with the quote you mentioned earlier. Yeah. It's very efficient. It's just enough to get things done and to like move you forward. I love it. It seems like it's fairly understandable.
Great. So we're cooking quickly, and now what it says is, we will prepare a delicious and healthy egg and vegetable scramble for breakfast. We'll use eggs, a bit of milk, butter, cheese, and a dash of pepper from our available ingredients. If we go shopping, we can add in some asparagus and zucchini for extra flavor and nutrients, and sauteing them. I'm getting kind of hungry now. Now we know what to shop for. Let's get instructions based upon the available things at our grocer, and this is our shopping list. I should get the asparagus and zucchinis. Got it. Now we're going to plate the meal using another model for image generation, Dall-E. Bring it over. And we're going to, now we're going to have it generate an image of the meal that we are going to create. This sometimes turns out pretty bad here in the kitchen here. Tim, just get ready. Here it comes. Uh-huh. Oh, not bad. Not bad. All right, Tim. So there we have it.
All right.
We cooked together. We cooked this scramble. Okay. So, yeah. Tim. Your world does border on everything from hospitality to food. You have so many backgrounds, mind you. Big fan. By the way, if you are RGA agency fans, Tim is big in that world too. So just want to note, Tim, this technology wave you've been on top of for your entire career, what does it feel like when you consider craft and this kind of cooking?
I think there's just tools at your disposal that you have to learn to incorporate or dismiss. When I was in school, I had a graphic design teacher that used RubyLith when she was practicing, which was a very long time ago. It was a very like kind of ancient way of doing typography, and really wanted us to learn like RubyLith and so forth. And like it did play a big part in how I learned and sort of started to understand graphic design. And she was really against any sort of new technology. I think in the same way with AI, it's like, how do you use it? How can you embrace it? And how can you use it to push your own thinking forward, just like any other sort of advanced tool as well? So like, I myself really am looking forward to and kind of embracing it. It's kind of no end to where I think it's going to go. So it's kind of amazing.
Can we double click on that for a second? It's so core because by having been in that Japanese craft world for quite a while, you know that there's this weird world where doing it the old way is the right way. It is the way to do it. There's a right way and a wrong way, and that right way is pretty darn good. What is the new right way in craft with AI, you think, as designers?
I wouldn't be able to tell you because I think it is evolving as we speak. Like I can spend hours like trying to basically converse with Dall-E or Midjourney with Imagine prompts, trying to get like what's in my head sort of created within this the generative AI. And then also like being open to all the crazy paths that open up because you're like using basically another brain. It's fascinating. There is no benchmark in terms of like what craft is right now. However, speaking of like the established ways, there are ways that we know people communicate or effectively understand either like hierarchy and information architecture and so forth. And like we can use those benchmarks and standards and best practices in this new world. And I think that's going to develop a whole new class of benchmarks and guidelines and so forth to push everything forward.
So it's kind of like that Japanese famous swordsman Miyamoto Musashi, where most people had one sword and he had two swords. So it sounds like the craft is in the past craft and in this future evolving craft, you need both swords, it sounds like.
I think you need both swords to really become like a great samurai, as it were, to keep considering that analogy.
You heard it first here in the Cozy AI Kitchen, the samurai metaphor coming out. Whoa. Could you share your closing thoughts, Tim, for the audience? We have a nice audience of folks who are trying to like, many of them are creatives of all kinds, and they're sort of struggling through this new, highly evolving. It's not yet a craft yet. It's more making. It's not craft yet. But they want to aspire to craft. Do you have any words of wisdom to share with them?
Yeah. I mean, I have some words to stay away from. What are the 10 most dangerous words in the English language? It's what will other people think and what will other people say? So just try to dive in and find the joy in AI, in old craft, new technology, because I think joy and enthusiasm protect us from small thinking. And so like just continue to think big as possible. The sky's the limit with this new technology. And it doesn't matter if you're a novice or an expert in any domain, you can learn how to use it. So yeah, it's just a growth mindset and approaching things with the joyful spirit.
Wow, that was profound. What words should we not say? I just want to thank you, Tim. You just reminded me of my friend's mother's favorite saying. It goes something like, what people say about you behind your back is none of your business. All right. Well, thank you, Tim, for joining the Cozy AI Kitchen. Everyone out there, thanks for tuning in, and let's keep going in this AI evolution era.